Hi there, and thank you for tuning in. Exposure bracketing on your Nikon D700 is the subject for today. Here on the front right of your camera, you have a little function button. And if you have your camera set up to factory settings, it will, when you push this button, it will activate in the LCD, it will activate the setup for bracketing. So while I'm showing you all the things I'm about to show you on the top LCD, I'm actually pushing this button when I'm changing the values, just so you know that you have to actually push this button while you do the other changes. So the button I was talking about, it sits down here, and in my left hand, I'm pushing that button as I'm showing you here what to do. But if you push that button, you will see that a menu appears here in the LCD display. It says right now 0F and 1.0. And you have to set up two things. One is the number of pictures that you want to go into your bracketing. And the other thing is how many exposure value jumps do you want it to take for each time it takes a new picture. So in this case, let's say I take three pictures. I've turned the rare command dial, and now you can see plus minus the exposure compensation is flashing, and it also says BKT for bracketing. So this means now bracketing is activated. If I release the button on the front of the camera, you will see that the bracketing stays on to indicate that now we have bracketing activated. And you can also see there are now three dots below the exposure scale telling me that there will be taken three pictures as a consequence of the way the bracketing is set up. So let's try, I push the button again and show you some more examples here. I can take five pictures, I can take seven, I can go even up to nine. And as you can see in the display, it tries to illustrate how many values I have chosen. So you can see now we have three bars, now we have five, seven, and if I go to nine, it just shows me some arrows to show that there are more than what it can show. Let's go back to three here. If I then push the button and take the first picture, you will notice how the middle dot sort of disappeared. If I take one more, the left one disappears, meaning now it's taken the normally exposed and one underexposed, and now it's taken the overexposed, and it's ready to take three more pictures. So that's basically how it works. If you wanted to jump in other values than full stops, then what you can do is you can change the value here on the front command dial, and you see top right here now it's 0.3. 0.7 and 1.0. 1.0 is the maximum jump you can take. And I think that's a little bit of a pity because normally I take three pictures and on my D750 and then I jump two stops up and two stops down, and that works very fine. In this case, I will have to get the same effect. I will have to take five pictures and then just use picture one, three, and five. But of course, this is subject to personal preference. But as you can see, that is actually all the configuration there is to it. Then there is a little pro tip, because right now I'm shooting here, as you can see bottom left here, I'm shooting in single mode. If you put it in one of the continuous modes, let's say you put it in continuous high, then you don't have to push the shutter for each picture that you want to take. You just hold down the shutter and boom, it has taken five pictures in this case, right? So that works really, really well. And I think it actually applies for all the continuous mode. The way your camera varies the exposure is subject to what mode you have the camera in. You can see right now I'm in aperture priority, so it will now try to vary the shutter speed. Had I been in shutter priority mode, it would have varied the aperture, and had I been in program mode, then it has sort of been able to play with all values. So that's the way it works. It varies whatever you leave it of options to work with. Having taken these pictures, next step is now to dive into Lightroom and merge the pictures into one. So I took five pictures bracketed of my window space. And as you can see here, the first picture is the normally exposed, then follows the two overexposed, and then bottom here we have the two underexposed. I asked for, as you can see, five pictures in total with one exposure stop for each of these pictures. So this is one stop overexposed, two stop, one stop underexposed, and two stop underexposed. And if we just look at the histogram, if I walk through these, you can see even the normally exposed picture is a bit lefty, and if I go to the overexposed one, you can see how the histogram moves to the right, and same or the opposite when I go to the underexposed pictures. You can see especially the last one becomes very, very lefty. Now we can ask Lightroom to pick the best parts from each of these pictures, but before we do that, I just wanted to show you here, if we go in and look at each of these pictures in terms of camera settings, you can see what it is the camera does. I asked it to keep aperture constant because I was in aperture priority mode. You will see f8 is constant throughout the pictures. ISO 1000 is perhaps a little bit unusual, but that was because I was shooting yesterday in a low light situation, so I forgot to change that, but it doesn't really matter. So the first picture was at 1/5000, and you will see if I go to the next picture, you can see that now for the two overexposed, it lowers the shutter speed to let in more light. And then if we go to the underexposed, you can see now it has increased the shutter speed, and even when it goes to the two stops underexposed, it tells me 1/8000 of a second. That's actually the max shutter speed for the D700. So it has really made this picture very, very dark. If we go back to the grid here, we can select all the pictures pressing Control A, and then you merge these pictures pressing Control H, as in HDR, I guess. And when you do that, you can see now it says creating HDR preview. I leave auto align auto settings on. I select the highest deghost amount, and I ask not to create a stack because I don't like stacking, but that's of course personal preference. Now it has merged it, or actually it has made a preview of the merger, and you can see all five pictures successfully merged. If it cannot figure out how to merge the pictures, then it will tell you here, and it will tell you how many pictures it managed to get into the process here. Then you just say merge, and a background job starts, and towards the end of that work, a new sixth picture will appear. And you will notice here that if we look at the name, it says HDR as part of the name, meaning this is the merged picture. If we just take this picture and compare that to the original picture, you can see that these two pictures, the one to the left with the HDR is much better in terms of exposure. You can see there's much more details and color in the dark parts, and still the bright parts are not blown out as far as I can tell. So this is the way HDR works. It simply takes the best from all the pictures you have taken with the bracketing and combine them into one picture. And that's really all there is to it. You can of course do this also in Photoshop or probably many other post-processing tools, but I just illustrated here how to do it in Lightroom. So when it comes to exposure bracketing and the question of why you want to deal with that, let's imagine you have a scale here that goes from something that it's very, very dark. I didn't know how to illustrate that. And then the brightest of bright, meaning on a sunny day, you're standing outside and it's, you know, as much light as you can imagine. Throughout this range, you have all, let's just say, shades of gray. And your human eye is amazing in the sense that it can really see a lot of things at the same time. And this is important. It's at the same time. You can actually see, you can say, details in the gray and the black, and you can at the same time see distinguish between colors in the high end of the scale, meaning that parts of what you see that is extremely bright. The problem is that your camera, as per usual, is not as clever as your eyes and your brain in combination. So your camera can only see, let's say, it only sees this part. This is sort of illustrative and conceptual. So don't judge me that this is not super precise, but it goes to illustrate a point. The thing is that when your camera can only see this much, as this is actually its dynamic range, so it goes from here to here, how many stops of light can you actually span across at the same time with one picture in your camera? Because what happens is everything that is brighter, meaning to the right here, will be clipped, as it's called, meaning that everything will simply be white here, and the same goes, you will lose detail in the shadows here, so that everything here will simply be black. So all the details you have from here to the left and the details you have from here to the right, they will be lost. And this is where exposure bracketing comes into the picture, because what you do is you take several pictures. One, let's just say you're taking three pictures, then you take one that is a bit overexposed, maybe this much, then you take one that is correctly exposed, like this much, And then you take another one, which is a bit underexposed, like this much. And if you manage successfully in post-processing software to combine these pictures and pick the right parts of the picture, of the three pictures into one, then you will get one picture that in combination gives you much more dynamic range than you would have otherwise if you just had the one up here. And that's the whole point with exposure bracketing. So this is typically what you do in bracketing. You take one that is normally exposed, one that is a bit overexposed, so you can actually see the details in the dark, and one that is a bit underexposed, so you can see the details in the highlights, and then you combine the three. This combination here is what Lightroom will do, and I've showed you how to do that, but this is actually about picking the right parts of the picture and combining them into one. Your smartphone is born with this. It's called HDR. It's actually the same. So the process of taking these three pictures, combining them into one, you know, that's known as HDR in your smartphone. This is high dynamic range, and the point is exactly the same as here, and it does exactly all this. It's just sort of hidden behind the scenes. So that's why I think you should be really interested in high dynamic range or bracketing, because you will be able to capture more details in the dark, more details in the highlights in the same picture when you have a scene where there's lots of darks and there's lots of light.